Okay, so now we will continue with the talk about arthritis. Dr. Shirin will talk to us about seronegative arthritis.
Good morning, everyone. Today I will talk about seronegative arthritis. Also a few points about collagen vascular diseases that are affecting the joint, as well as crystal deposition arthritis. Seronegative arthropathies are including ankylosing spondylitis, inflammatory bowel disease associated arthritis, psoriatic arthritis, and reactive arthritis. They all share in common arthritis, but there is a negative rheumatoid factor, but are usually HLA-B27 positive, which is a human leukocyte antigen. The hallmark of spondyloarthropathies is sacroiliitis, that is involving the inferior portion of the sacroiliac joint, and it is a synovial one, and it is starting from the iliac aspect of the sacroiliac joint. In order to differentiate between these four types of seronegative arthritis and to characterize them, we have to know whether the sacroiliitis is symmetric or asymmetric, is it unilateral or bilateral. If it is symmetric sacroiliitis, it is usually caused by ankylosing spondylitis and inflammatory bowel diseases. If it is asymmetric sacroiliitis, we should think of psoriatic or reactive arthritis. In unilateral sacroiliitis is caused by septic arthritis. In such condition, the patient will present with acute pain, usually he is febrile. In addition, there will be history of immunocompression and intravenous drug abuse. This is a frontal radiograph.
Immune compression.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. This is a frontal radiograph of the pelvis that is demonstrating bilateral. That is showing bilateral symmetrical sclerosis that is involving the inferior portion and the iliac side of the sacroiliac joint. This is a magnified view that is demonstrating clearly the widening of the sacroiliac joint and irregular sclerosis. The axial CT scan of the pelvis bone window demonstrating widening of the sacroiliac joint, sclerosis, as well as erosion demonstrating bilateral symmetrical sacroiliitis.
So this is either ankylosing spondylitis
or inflammatory bowel disease associated arthritis.
Or reactive arthritis,
yes. Yes. صح. لا مو reactive.
Ah, sorry, right. I'm sorry, writers.
The first seronegative spondyloarthropathy is ankylosing spondylitis that is seen in young men presenting with back pain and stiffness. Ankylosing spondylitis can be associated with pulmonary fibrosis with upper lobe predominance, aortitis, as well as cardiac conduction defects. As we said, there will be bilateral symmetrical sacroiliitis in the form of joint space widening, sclerosis, and marginal erosion. Subsequently,
the iliac side.
Yes,
sharp.
Inferior portion, starting from the iliac side. Yes. Subsequently, the spine will be invariably involved, and it ascends from the lumbar to the cervical spine. Romanus lesions are erosions that are affecting the anterior, superior, or inferior vertebral end plate. It is more obvious in this sagittal CT scan of the lower lumbar vertebrae bone window demonstrating increased sclerosis of the anterior superior vertebral end plate of L4 and L5. The Romanus lesions are usually seen anteriorly, but they could be posterior or they could be a combination of both. The syndesmophytes represent bony bridging connecting adjacent vertebral margin, which create the classic bamboo spine, spinal ankylosis in the late stage of the disease. It is more obvious here in this image that showing the difference between the syndesmophytes and the osteophytes. The osteophytes are associated with degenerative disc disease, while in cases of syndesmophytes, there is only ossification of the annulus fibers and the interspinous ligaments.
And keep in mind, ankylosis is usually in young people.
Yes.
So when you see some osteophytes or syndesmophytes in young, it is unusual.
Yes.
You see osteophytes in older,
age group,
which are not affected by spondyloarthropathies or ankylosis spondylitis. I mean.
Yes. As you mentioned, doctor, this is two frontal radiograph of the lumbar spine. In both of them are a young male patient. The first one is a 30-year male. The red arrow are pointing to the multiple growing syndesmophytes, while the second one is of a 37-year male showing multiple syndesmophytes that are bridging the vertebral body, forming what's called the ankylosed spine or bamboo spine. They are resembling it into these bamboo trees. In advanced disease, the fully ankylosed spine is at a very high risk for fracture, so CT scan is necessary even in cases of minimal trauma in patients with AS. Another sign that is highly specific for the ankylosing spondylitis is dagger sign that is seen in the frontal lumbar radiograph, that is a dense line caused by ossification of the supraspinous and interspinous ligaments. Inflammatory bowel diseases as Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, Whipple, as well as post-operative patients that are undergoing gastric bypass may present with sacroiliitis that is usually bilateral and symmetrical. This is a CT scan of the pelvis bone window demonstrating widening of the sacroiliac joint with sclerosis. This is a CT scan of the pelvis of the same patient, soft tissue window, that is demonstrating bowel wall thickening, mural stratification with post-contrast enhancement, suggesting inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn enteritis. The third entity of seronegative arthritis is psoriatic arthritis. It is seen in patients with skin psoriasis, most commonly affect the hand. And here the sacroiliitis is bilateral, but it is asymmetrical. The mineralization is preserved, and this is a differentiating point from rheumatoid arthritis. Patients with psoriatic arthritis may present in many forms, whether oligoarthritis, polyarthritis, arthritis moyotilans, as well as spondyloarthropathy. The radiographic findings in the hand will be soft tissue swelling, pencil and cup erosion, mostly affecting the distal interphalangeal joints. Although it is bilateral, but usually the involvement is asymmetrical. This is a PA radiograph of both hands that skeletally mature patient demonstrating distal erosive change, also involving the proximal interphalangeal joint. The erosion are more clear in the carpal bone. This is another frontal radiograph of the hand in a psoriatic patient that is showing erosive change of the distal and proximal interphalangeal joint, but the carpal bone are clear. So a differential point of the psoriatic arthritis from rheumatoid arthritis is that bone mineralization is preserved. In addition, the erosions of psoriatic arthritis have a more frayed margin that is due to periostitis at the attachment site. This image is demonstrating the normal square configuration of phalanx. While in this pencil in cup deformity, there is loss of both sides, and they are resembling it into what's called mouse ear that is usually affecting the distal surface. In the foot, the great toe, interphalanx, and metatarsophalangeal joint are most commonly affected. We have an ivory phalanx that is highly specific for psoriatic arthritis, in which there will be marginal sclerosis of a single phalanx. Psoriatic arthritis produces a plantar calcaneal spur with periosteal reaction. In addition, the psoriatic arthritis also involves the spine, in which case it will cause coarse bony bridging, and it will be difficult to differentiate it from reactive arthritis because both of them will cause coarse bony bridging. This is frontal radiograph of both foot that is demonstrating what we discussed, ivory phalanx, in which there is global sclerosis of the single distal phalanx. It is more obvious in this frontal radiograph of the hand, there is global sclerosis of the middle phalanx of the middle finger. It is highly specific for psoriatic arthritis. The last seronegative spondyloarthropathy is reactive arthritis, reactive arthropathy, previously called Reiter's disease or Reiter's syndrome, as it is thought to be a sequelae of infectious diarrhea, urethritis, or cervicitis. It is causing bilateral asymmetrical sacroiliitis. Radiographically, it most commonly affect the feet, radiographically demonstrated as diffuse soft tissue swelling, joint space loss, aggressive marginal erosion, and in the end stage causes juxtra-articular osteopenia, cause the bone mineralization is preserved until late in the disease. The calcaneus is a common site of involvement. In the hand, reactive arthropathy affects the interphalangeal joints and metatarsophalangeal with erosion and the physial periostitis. As we said, in psoriatic arthritis, the spine is also involved, cause coarse bony bridging. This is AP view of the first through the fourth toe in a patient with reactive arthritis that is showing erosive disease with bone proliferation of the second and third metatarsophalangeal joint. This is radiograph of the heel in a patient with reactive arthritis, in which demonstrating periosteal reaction at the plantar fascia insertion, as well as sclerosis at the site of Achilles tendon insertion. Connective tissue disorders affecting the joint, we will discuss systemic lupus erythematosus. And joint abnormalities is seen in nearly 90% of patients with systemic lupus erythematosus. The key radiographic finding is subluxation of the metacarpophalangeal and proximal interphalangeal joint. And the problem here, when we do a PA view of the hand, because the hand is positioned to the cassette, we cannot see the subluxation. But when we do an oblique view, the subluxations will be very clear. As in this, demonstrated in this image, this is the PA and oblique view of the left hand, and this is PA and oblique view of the right hand. As you see in the right, in the PA views, we cannot clearly demonstrate the subluxation, although ulnar deviation is seen. But in the oblique views, we can see the subluxation clearly. And these findings are also seen in Jacot erythropathy. They both share the same entity. There is ulnar deviation and subluxation demonstrated on oblique view. And this will be reducible by physical manipulation. Scleroderma is another systemic collagen vascular disease caused by collagen deposition in the skin and soft tissues. That is starting in the fingertips. We have a term of acroosteolysis defined as resorption of the distal portion of the distal phalanx. This acroosteolysis has many differentials as collagen vascular disease, including scleroderma, neuropathy, polyvinyl chloride exposure, thermal injury, hyperparathyroidism. But how we make sure that this is scleroderma? There will be extensive dystrophic soft tissue and periarticular calcification. And if we see this combination, it is highly suggestive of scleroderma. And consequently, there will be tightening and fibrosis of the skin and often leads to joint contractures.
You know, the name is scleroderm. The derm, yes, is sclerosed. The derm is the skin.
Yes.
Is involved. So it's just what you have said. We have to look for the soft tissue abnormality.
Yes.
Diagnosis.
This is frontal radiograph of both hands. That is showing distal resorption of the distal phalanx with periarticular osteopenia. This is suggestive of, yani we have a list of differential, as we said, five. But if we see this dystrophic extensive soft tissue and periarticular calcification, so this is scleroderma. Last connective tissue disease is polymyositis and dermatomyositis, are idiopathic condition characterized by inflammation of muscle, polymyositis, or inflammation of muscle and skin, dermatomyositis, as seen in this lateral radiograph of the lower limb, that is demonstrating diffuse dystrophic calcification involving the posterior aspect of the soft tissue of the leg, And also there is linear skin calcification of the anterior aspect of the leg. This is dermatomyositis. The intramuscular calcification are most common, although subcutaneous calcification may also be seen similar to scleroderma. Crystal deposition erythropathy. We have calcium hydroxyapatite deposition disease, abbreviated as HAD. It is also called calcific tendinitis. Here the crystals are deposited in the periarticular tissue. This is important to memorize it in order to differentiate it from the CPPD, because here the cartilage, the articular cartilage and synovium are not involved. They are spared. And most commonly they are involving the supraspinatus tendon in the rotator cuff, as seen in this frontal radiograph of the shoulder, demonstrating calcification at the supraspinatus tendon insertion to the greater tuberosity. And this is calcific tendinitis. Also, calcific tendinitis may affect the longus coli muscle, as seen in this sagittal CT scan of the cervical spine bone window that is showing calcification of the longus coli muscle, also seen in this lateral radiograph of the cervical spine. And here we have differential diagnosis, that is a perivertebral abscess, because in both these conditions the patient will present with neck pain, odynophagia, fever and perivertebral effusion. So in such condition we should take in consideration calcific tendinitis of the longus coli muscle. Calcium pyrophosphate dihydrate deposition disease is caused by the intraarticular deposition of calcium pyrophosphate dihydrate crystal. Patient may have many clinical presentation, but most commonly they manifest as pseudo-osteoarthritis. Less commonly, patient may be asymptomatic in 10 to 20%, or may present as pseudogout in 10 to 20%, and less commonly, patient may present with pseudo-rheumatoid or pseudo-neuropathic. Usually, CPPD is rare in patients under 50, and it may be idiopathic or secondary to hemochromatosis, hyperparathyroidism, and hypophosphatasia. The hallmark radiographic finding of CPPD disease is chondrocalcinosis. We said in HAD, the cartilage are not involved, but here there is calcification of the cartilage or fibrocartilage. And radiograph of the knee, wrist, and pelvis are 100% specific for the diagnosis, as demonstrated in this frontal radiograph of the knee joint. That is, there is meniscal calcification, and this is another example just of meniscal calcification.
100% sensitive, not 100% specific.
Yes, sensitive.
Okay.
Yes.
Yani, it will detect the calcification very early.
Yes.
Cause of the calcification?
We don't. Yes.
Differentials. The main differential is CPPD, okay?
Yes. In the wrist, chondrocalcinosis tends to affect the triangular fibrocartilage complex. The triangular fibrocartilage complex is composed of the triangular fibrocartilage disc proper, the ulno meniscal homolog, as well as lots multiple of tendon and ligaments that are supporting the wrist for the rotation and grasping movement. And CPPD usually causes type 2. Triangular fibrocartilage complex. Type 1 is caused by either trauma or rheumatoid arthritis. And the advanced disease may lead to scapholunate advanced collapse, as seen in this frontal radiograph of the wrist joint, in which there is a joint space narrowing and subchondral sclerosis of the radio scaphoid joint, widening of the scapholunate space, but this space is filled by the proximal migration of the capitate. The capitate should be in the distal row. Finally, gout is a crystal-induced inflammatory erythropathy caused by sodium urate deposition in the joint. Hyperuricemia may be secondary to under-excretion, which is more common, typically caused by renal insufficiency. Rarely may be due to overproduction, typically seen in a younger patient. Of course, it takes an interval of 10 to 20 years of hyperuricemia in order to the patient to present with clinical manifestation of gout. As you know, the great toe is most commonly involved, but any joint can be involved. What's important to memorize here is that bone mineralization is preserved and the joint spaces are typically well preserved until in the advanced disease. Radiographic findings will be marginated erosions with overhanging margin associated with soft tissue gouty tophi. This is a radiograph of the foot that demonstrating the marginal erosion with the overhanging cortex. Typically, the bone mineralization is preserved and the joint spaces are well seen. This is a frontal and lateral radiograph of the foot that is showing soft tissue swelling, marginal erosion with overhanging cortex, but the bone mineralization seems to be normal as well as the joint spaces are normal. So this is typical for gout. And thank you so much for listening.
Shireen, what's the most common joint affected by gout, the first joint affected?
It is the metatarsophalangeal.
Of?
Big toe.
Of big toe.
Yes.
The metatarsophalangeal joint of the big toe, first and most commonly affected.
Yes.
Okay. What the affection of this joint by gout, it has a name. This patient has what?
Hallux.
It's called podagra. Podagra.
Podagra.
When you hear podagra, this means gout affecting the first metatarsophalangeal joint in acute attack. It comes in. شايفتي واحد عنده gout داء الملوك داء النقرس.
إيه دكتور.
The when you eat red meat, it will inflame and swell
soft
and you have very bad night, especially the metatarsophalangeal joint.
Yes.
Any other questions?
The most common site of CPVD in the joint or knee joint.
Okay.
The most common joint affected ankylosing spondylitis, bad in the spondyloarthropathy, bad in the spine or hip joint.
Good. Good notes. Sergio. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.